Examination of the lymph nodes for abnormalities is an essential part of the physical exam. We have hundreds of lymph nodes throughout our body. Most of them we cannot feel or palpate because they are small or deep and they cannot be felt. But to our surprise, if you do a radical dissection of the neck or the axilla or the pelvis, we may find 10, 15, or 20 lymph nodes in that operation, which were never appreciated. Lymph nodes are virtually always abnormal in the sense that they arose from some preceding process, usually an infection, early in life, and then they maintain their small size for life. In the examination of lymph nodes, to determine serious problems, there are a number of characteristics that are important. The most important, of course, is their size, because lymph nodes are generally thought to be virtually normal or insignificant when they are 2 centimeters or less. At least that's the criteria that radiologists use in examining the abdomen. That's more or less true in the other parts of the body. There are some parts of the body, such as the armpits or the axillae, in which lymph glands may reach the size of 3 centimeters or even more and not be of concern. Occasionally on CT scan, you will see that those lymph nodes contain fat in the center and they are rather C-shaped, but their size under in the axilla can be larger than in other locations. Whereas in other locations, even a 1 centimeter or a smaller lymph node is of great concern, such as in the supraclavicular fossa, where lymph nodes are not usually the residual of old infection and indicate more serious problems. Other than size, the next important consideration is how they feel when you palpate them. Are they soft, hard, something in between, which we call rubbery? Each of those means something slightly different. Normal or insignificant lymph nodes are usually soft. Very hard lymph nodes are much more concern. If they're stone hard, or then we more often think of a malignancy. Occasionally, an old infection, particularly a granulomatous infection, can leave you with hard lymph nodes. Intermediate consistency are what we call rubbery. And rubbery lymph nodes are often a sign of lymphoma, which is a primary tumor, of course, of a lymph node system. The other important characteristic is whether they are tender or non-tender. Tender lymph nodes, as you palpate them, are almost always a sign of infection. And malignancies that involve the lymph nodes are usually not tender, with the occasional exception when they grow very rapidly. And that's not common. The other important consideration is the age of the patient. Youngsters, children from ages 2 to 12, very frequently have lymph nodes, especially in the neck, posterior cervical, mid-cervical, occasionally in other peripheral sites, which are due to frequent viral or other bacterial infections that they get in the nose and throat, and is a normal part of maturation of the patient and of the immune system. as one gets older, then you may not want to feel lymph nodes that are acceptable in children. So the examination, which I am about to show you, is just part of the consideration, and I'd be glad to go ahead now.
Okay,
thank you. So to begin with, I always have my patients seated, and that's the best way to feel lymph glands from the waist up. And often we do that symmetrically, because lymph nodes are usually not symmetrical in their enlargements, especially abnormal lymph nodes. So we often use 2 hands, and we start in the posterior occipital region, and occasionally you feel lymph glands. This gentleman has a very hard lump in the back of his head, which is not a lymph node, and you have to distinguish bone from a lymph node. But up here he has about a 2 centimeter firm bony protuberance. It is not a lymph node, and it's nothing of concern. As you come down, you just palpate with your fingers until you get to the posterior auricular area, and lymph nodes can be felt there. Usually they are abnormal, even when they're quite small in this location. And you use your fingers gently, and then you come down to the general neck area. There's another place that's important with the preauricular lymph nodes. And you feel with your fingers, gently, symmetrically, and you don't usually feel preauricular lymph nodes. Even small ones would be of concern. May mean an infection, may mean something more generalized. As you come down then to the mandible, or the angle of the mandible, the parotid gland may be felt in this location. In this gentleman, we don't feel the parotid gland, but it would be symmetrical and may overlap that angle, and they are not lymph nodes. And then you come down along the sternocleidomastoid muscle, and you palpate for jugular lymph nodes. And you go up and down, gently if you can, all the way down to the clavicle. And these would be the jugular lymph nodes, cervical lymph nodes. And what's very important to distinguish is that there are submandibular salivary glands, which are symmetrical usually, maybe slightly different one side from the other. And this gentleman has a salivary gland right here, which is about 1.5 centimeters and small. And he has a smaller one on this side. But they are symmetrical, and they are not concerned, and they are not lymph nodes, in my judgment. The other thing you have to be aware of is that the carotid arteries are here. And very often, you will feel the carotid artery or carotid bulb and interpret that as a swollen lymph nodes. But lymph nodes do not pulsate. And when they pulsate, that means it's obviously a carotid artery. And they are in this location. Now, this gentleman has a very small lymph gland on the right side, in the posterior cervical region, right here. It's probably no more than 3 millimeters. It's flat. Lymph nodes that are normal are usually flat and ovoid. Lymph nodes that are more abnormal are spherical, and that you can sort of tell by your palpation. You come down, and the most important area to feel is the supraclavicular fossa. Now, sometimes it's a little better to just bend the neck forward to relax this area. And you take your fingers and you push right down over the clavicle and see if you can roll your fingers over any nodules. Now, these are most important because they are not usually found normally after infections. And if they are enlarged, they often indicate some process which is deeper in the body. And the most important one is on the left side. And as you probably have read and remember, the left supraclavicular lymph node is called the sentinel lymph node or Virchow's node because it was an indication that there was serious trouble in the abdomen. Now, why in the left supraclavicular fossa would that indicate abdominal disease? Well, you will recall that the lymphatics of the abdomen drain to the cisternic hilli, and then go up the thoracic duct, and they dump into the left side, left jugular vein. And if there is malignancy in this location, and it is spread to a lymph node, very frequently the first sign of that disease is a swollen and firm left supraclavicular lymph node. And you shouldn't feel a lymph node in this location, at least normally. That doesn't mean that they're always bad, but that it should raise your suspicion. On the right side, occasionally the thoracic duct will split and send some lymph and cells to the right side, but the intrathoracic lymphatics drain to the right supraclavicular fossa. So this is another very important place to feel. And then you continue to feel around and make sure that it's symmetrical. Be sure to distinguish the muscles from the carotid vessels. The hyoid bone is here and it shouldn't be confused with lymph nodes. It's firm. And you push on one side, it goes to the other. And many young medical students or doctors will confuse the hyoid bone and the larynx. Hyoid bone is higher, but it's bony and it moves.